Hey guys, Lauren Southern here with Stefan Molyneux.
Can you say it for me? It's okay to be white?
Well, I wouldn't consider myself
Can you say
white.
It's okay to be white?
You That's wouldn't consider thing. Yourself white?
No.
What would you consider yourself?
Indigenous Māori.
Okay.
Well, that was a bit awkward. That was Lauren Southern and Stefan Molyneux, the Canadians who have caused all this controversy over the last, well, couple of weeks, really. Mm-hmm. I want to come to you first, Stephen Franks, because you sort of went in there to try and bat for them to get them here with the Phil Goff situation. Why should New Zealanders welcome these guys to come and speak here when they're speaking real fringe stuff?
Well, the New Zealanders don't have to welcome them. We didn't have any desire to welcome. We just wanted people to be allowed to make up their own decision as to who they heard, not have politicians make it for them. I think countries where politicians make up their decide who you can hear and who you can't, who you can question or challenge.
But in the end, no politicians did. It was just Phil Goff.
Well, Phil Goff said repeatedly that he had the power to do it, and a whole lot of people jumped in behind him, which was a transformation. If that's the kind of country you're in,
did
that's
it bother
very
you? Did it conflict you? Did you lie at sleep at night thinking, what am I doing defending the rights of these people who spew bile?
Well, I didn't care what they said.
No, 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 no. But why didn't you care what they said?
Because
don't
I believe.
Know whether it's
I believe
hate in speech or whatever it is.
No, that is the person who hears them who makes up their mind. I'm here. I'm there for the fundamental rights. There's four of them in the Bill of Rights: freedom of speech, freedom of thought and religion, freedom of peaceful assembly, and freedom of association.
So, if they were a Holocaust denier, you wouldn't
freedom
care whether
it. No,
New Zealand has always been a very sound believer in freedom of speech.
Okay.
We've had Holocaust deniers, we've had Scientologists, we've had a lot of very, very unpleasant people speaking, and we should be allowed to see them and decide, yes, that's unpleasant.
Okay,
no, but it's not unpleasant, it's hate speech. Do you not agree?
There's
that
no
that
difference.
Hate speech?
It's hate speech just as a way of people to try to say, I don't believe in free speech, but I can't say that, so I'll call something hate speech, and that's not free. That's all it is.
That is absolute nonsense. There's a lot of research that's been done on hate speech, and what it does, hate speech, it silences its victims. It causes them to withdraw because of fear. It causes them to move from their jobs, leave neighbourhoods. And
let's be clear about the bit that you're arguing is hate speech. We're talking about they argue on the IQ thing of racial superiority.
It's not just that. They argue that... for example, their comments around Aboriginal culture and that, you know, white people have done more in 256 years than Aborigines did in 40,000 years, and therefore it was a good thing that you took the land from them.
So we need to look at that in the context of this country and in terms of our bicultural framework for our country, and therefore if they're talking about multiculturalism as a danger and trying to make people feel threatened so that they fight back, that's when you incite hate. So telling people that they are threatened is where it becomes dangerous, whereas it's not necessarily true in terms of whether they face a danger from
I am threatened. I am threatened when Anjum and the Islamic Federation says we don't want someone coming here who doesn't like Islam.
I didn't mention Islam. I'm talking about people. And I'm talking about the fact that what these people do and say, can I please finish?
Please let me finish my sentence.
What I am saying to you is that these acts of hate speech have an impact on people's daily lives. And what I'm saying to you...
What acts of hate speech?
What I'm saying to you is, when would you draw the line? When there are people with tiki torches on the street and driving cars into people and killing them?
For 100 years...
Would you stop the line when we start wearing yellow stars?
I'll tell you where the law is.
Would you stop it when they are on cattle trains?
I want to bring Bryce in here for a comment.
I mean, we can clearly see that, you know, we've got this looming culture war, and it's happening on this panel.
Is it happening? I think so, yes.
It's actually happening throughout the globe at the moment.
It's an escalation of new debates,
and we're seeing over the last 5 years there's been this rise of radicalism, and we're seeing it with these Canadian duo, this reactionary version of it, but we're seeing it on the left, we're seeing it amongst gender politics, ethnicity politics. It's happening everywhere.
And is New Zealand hostile to that free speech?
I think everywhere is having to deal with these radical views, especially when they're pushing the boundaries, and we have to find a way of dealing with it. And at the moment, the way of dealing with it is to try and ban it. And there will be consequences if we go down that route. I mean, it is a logical way to do it, but it means that I think other groups, marginalised groups, oppressed groups, will end up being banned as well.
But there's the internet. I mean, people can watch
you. You don't need a stage to have a platform. And what they've done is performed an excellent PR opportunity. We've been talking about people that I didn't know about a month ago. And therefore, in terms of their free speech, that is welcomed on other platforms. You don't need to be at a particularly privately owned venue like the power station.
Well, the question, though, about rights of assembly and association is that you actually do, because you're getting a filtered message through almost all media. People actually want to go and say, can I look at, what sort of body language do I see? They want to hear other people's questions in the meeting. I didn't want to go and hear them because our researchers said, some of it's quite offensive. They've set out to be agent provocateur, just in
There's
the same way.
There's nothing filtered on his YouTube channel. I mean, you can go and watch half an hour lectures if you really, really want.
It's structured the way he wants it. The thing about meetings is that they're not structured. They'll get questions
and
challenges.
Meeting. Did you see the rules
Would you mind letting me finish?
Okay.
That at a meeting, you actually get a chance to make up your mind directly. You see body language, but more importantly, you see the other people at the meeting and you make up your mind, how are they feeling?
And do you think the people going to that meeting were there to be open-minded about what was going to be said?
As I said, we're there for the right to do it. I don't actually care about that meeting. It doesn't worry me that it was stopped, except that it's a trend that changes our society dramatically.
Okay.
And I didn't like Phil Goff saying...
Yeah, I just want to go back to what Bryce is saying. This is not new. It happened in the 1930s and 40s in Germany. It's happening in Myanmar with the Rohingyas. It happened in Rwanda. It's happened all around the world and it's happening all the time. And what the research on hate speech shows is that acts of racist violence are preceded by vilification in speech. That we create the atmosphere that makes violence acceptable because the victims of that speech are so vilified that people then act it out. And that's what I'm saying is, like, if you were living in the 1930s, at what point would you have said, right, we have to stop this. We can't have this language that is going to end up at this place.
Okay.
There are all these offensive things being said, and I think you're right, it's increasing. But it's a question of how do you deal with it? Do you suppress it? And does that work? I think we've seen over the last couple of weeks it doesn't work. It's had the counter effect.
Actually,
that we've had
I
more.
I disagree with you. I think it's really worked. If there had been no protests, they had come here.
We wouldn't have discussed it.
You wouldn't have heard about them.
Can I just finish? I've been to a speech like this. That was real vilification. I've sat through it. There was over 100 people in the room. Those people, there was no question and answer session. That's what I was going to say to you. I'm sorry I interrupted you. That there were strict rules to their meeting and there would not have been a debate.
Okay, one last comment from you, Stacey, before we go to the break.
In terms of free speech, freedom of speech, whose freedom of speech do we always protect? And in terms of, say, for instance, Taika Waititi, as a Māori man saying that New Zealand is racist, no one responded in terms of that was his freedom of speech to express his opinion. It was more about how dare he say that. So in these experiences, it is important that we look at what we think about this, where we stand, and what we support, and at what point we define that this is hate speech.
All right, we'll come back to the panel for some hits and misses towards the end, but before we go to the next break, something a little light-hearted. Fenner is continuing her tour of parliamentary offices. This week, Paula Bennett opened the door, and I hope she didn't regret it.